Greetings. Beyond haggling over silliness such as the only son jihad, or claiming the Torah teaches Hagar carried Ishmael, a deeper question I have been pondering is, what does it even mean? What does Islam claim was the reason Ishmael was offered? What does the Bible claim was the reason Isaac was offered? Let's first give an honest look at the Quran's explanation. Surah 37:99. And he said, Verily I am going to my Lord who will guide me. Now the nearly universal reading is like this, Go to my Lord. But when I tried to examine this, it is explained like the following. And then he said, Indeed, I will go to where I am ordered by my Lord, he will guide me. It bugs me when people must explain away the actual text. My Lord, grant me offspring, another translator insertion, from the righteous. The word offspring is added to clarify a dodgy meaning. The Al-Kuli Karai, My Lord, give me one of the righteous. The literal, My Lord, grant me of the righteous. The literal word-by-word reading sounds like Abraham is begging for himself to be found among the righteous. So we gave him good news of a compassionate child. When he, son, was old enough to walk with him, he said, O my son, surely I have seen in the sleep that I am slaughtering you. So what do you think? He said, O my father, do what you are commanded. You shall find me of the patient. So the Quran's story is of a dream Abraham had. Then when they had both submitted themselves, and he laid his son prostrate on his forehead, several translators add, for sacrifice. And the way this is told, it sounds immediate. We called out to him, O Abraham! You have fulfilled your dream, thus do we reward the good. That was indeed a trying test. And yes, it appears to be as immediate as it seems. No details, no travel, no mention of location. And we ransomed his son with a great sacrifice, and blessed Abraham with honorable mention among later generations. Peace be upon Abraham. Wait a minute. It says, we, meaning Allah, ransomed his son. What ransom? What was paid by Allah? What is the quid pro quo, Clarice? Was the whole ransom, the price, to save Ishmael, to give Abraham a good name in the future? Sadly, that is about all of the rationale why Allah would give Abraham a test of obedience. And this speaks volumes of the heart of the deity Muhammad invented for his religion. According to Islam, based on the Quran, Allah had no purpose other than to show Abraham would submit. Headline, Man kills son because of a bad dream. Move along now. Nothing to see here. This is a perfect example of the spiritual depth of Islam's whole message. About as deep as a puddle of water on a sand dune, what does Islam claim was the reason Ishmael was offered? To test Abraham and prove Abraham would submit to a dream given him in the night. If you are Muslim, and think you have more surah and ayat that apply? Produce your proof, brother. I'll cover that in another video. What does the Bible claim was the reason Isaac was offered? First, let's recount the Torah's account and see if your discernometer detects any differences. Genesis 22:1. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, Here I am, he, meaning Abraham, replied. First difference, Jehovah God spoke to Abraham. In the Quran's fable, Abraham only had a dream. O my son, surely I have seen in the sleep that I am slaughtering you. So what do you think? This is a dream of murder from Satan. That's what I think. Then God said, take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you. God tells Abraham to sacrifice as a burnt offering. If you dig, you will find this means the ascent offering, lifting up the offering to God. In the Quran's fable, it is a simple slaughter, beheading. Quran 37:103. Then when they had both submitted themselves, and he laid his son prostrate on his forehead for sacrifice. That's the position, to chop his head off. Go to the region of Moriah. On a mountain I will show you. This is another example or element of Abraham obeying an uncertain or ambiguous command from Jehovah God. It is to a region, and once there, God will again communicate the specific mountain place to build the altar. In the Quran's fable, it is right there in the same tent Ishmael slept in, for all we know. Then, right then, when they had both submitted themselves, 10 minutes of prayer, and he laid his son prostrate on his forehead for sacrifice. Early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. He loaded a donkey for the trip. He took two other servants with them. His preparations included cutting enough wood for the offering fire. What was Abraham thinking with each piece of wood he gathered, cut, and bundled? In the Quran's fable, there is no delay, no preparation, except a quickie submission prayer. Here we go, Allah. I saw in a dream. I'm killing my son, and I hear my wife scream. Inshallah, Allahu Akbar. You're the Lord of the worlds, a bitter old man. Hagar will hate me. That may be your plan. Amin. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. 3 days, Abraham has carried the burden of knowing he must sacrifice Isaac. Somewhere along the way, Jehovah God has told him, or showed him, where to go to perform the sacrifice. He said to his servants, stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you. I and the boy go over there. At this point, Abraham knows where he is going and what he must do. We will worship, and then we will come back to you. This seems to contradict Abraham's knowledge of the impending sacrifice. We must ask, what was Abraham really thinking? Hebrews 11:17. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac on the altar. He who had received the promises was ready to offer his one and only son. Even though God had said to him, through Isaac your offspring will be reckoned, Abraham reasoned that God could raise the dead. And in a sense, he did receive Isaac back from death. So the Bible, written by a man inspired by the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, lets us know what Abraham was thinking. Jehovah, I know you promised me a son through Sarah. And Jehovah, Sarah did conceive, and she did deliver a son that we called Isaac. And now, Jehovah, you are asking me to sacrifice Isaac to you. Jehovah, you can make a dead womb bring forth life. I believe you can raise Isaac from the dead as well. The Torah and Bible present a full, rich, detailed, and coherent record of the events, a sequence that took days to transpire. In the Quran's fable, there is no delay, no preparation, no time to think and ponder and stew and lament. Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife, and the two of them went on together. The son about to be sacrificed carried the wood he would soon be sacrificed on. If you have eyes to see, maybe you see another son carrying the cross he would die on. Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, "Father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" "Where is the lamb for God, Daddy?" If you are a parent, can you imagine this exchange? How much truth dare you answer? In the Quran's fable, Abraham launches with telling Ishmael that he had a dream of killing Ishmael. "Oh, my son, surely I have seen in the sleep that I am slaughtering you. So what do you think?" In Muhammad's fantasy, he does not say Allah gave the dream, but evidently Ishmael assumed that all dreams must come from their deity, Allah. He said, "O my father, do what you are commanded by Allah. You shall find me of the patient." But notice, "by Allah" is a translator insertion. That also is disturbing on multiple levels. "The fire and wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son," and the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. "Father, why are you binding my hands? Father, why are you setting me on the wood?" You know these events did not take place in silence, right? Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham!" "Here I am," he replied. On the verge of the act, not one moment too late. "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son." Here again the only son description is repeated. That reiterates, reinforces the significance of the sacrifice, and therefore the obedience, the commitment to the covenant. Abraham looked up, and there in the thicket he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So remember, a burnt offering is stated over and over in this real account. In the Quran's fable, it is a simple beheading. And that is a key difference. A burnt offering is offered to Jehovah God. A beheading is a way to murder an enemy of Allah. And that raises another huge, huge topic. Sacrificing a lamb or other animal as a burnt offering is a ritualistic practice of Judaism. But what animal sacrifice is ritually performed in Islam? What animal sacrifice is mentioned in the Quran? Surah 22:33. "You may benefit from the animals for an appointed time. Then they must be sacrificed in the ancient house." Read what it says. Raise the animal and benefit from it. Then sacrifice it at the ancient house. It does not say mosque. And to every nation we appointed acts of devotion, that they may mention the name of Allah on what he had given them of the cattle quadrupeds. So your God is one God, therefore to him you should submit and give good news to the humble. This is not a specific command for Mohammedans. This is another overreaching, all-sweeping claim for all nations. To those whose hearts tremble when Allah is mentioned, and those who are patient under that which afflicts them, and those who keep up prayer and spend out of what we have given them. Not really describing the sacrifice, but the people who fear Satan. I mean Allah. The sacrificial camels we have made for you as among the symbols from Allah. In them is much good for you. Then pronounce the name of Allah over them as they line up for sacrifice. When they are laid down on their sides after slaughter, eat you therefore, and feed such as beg not, but live in contentment, and such as beg with due humility. Thus have we made animals subject to you, that you may be grateful. But not every translation even includes the word sacrificial. Muhammad Asad, and as for the sacrifice of cattle, we have ordained it for you as one of the symbols set up by Allah. Pickthall, and the camels, we have appointed them among the ceremonies of Allah. The Abdul Hay, and the cows, oxen, or camels, offered as sacrifices by the pilgrims, we have made them for you as among the symbols of Allah. The Dr. Bakhtiar, we made for you the beasts of sacrifice among the waymarks of Allah. Then when they collapsed on their sides, eat from them and feed the ones who are paupers, and the ones who are poor persons who beg not. So part of the Hajj is to cook and eat these animals for barbecue. But there is no mention in the story of Ishmael of wood gathering or fire preparation. There does not reach Allah their flesh nor their blood, but to him is acceptable the guarding on your part. Thus has he made them subservient to you, that you may magnify Allah because he has guided you aright, and give good news to those who do good. This barbecue snack of sacrificial animals is unsatisfying to the heart that hungers for spiritual food. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And to this day it is said, "On the mountain of the Lord it will be provided." The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time, and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this, and have not withheld your son, your only son. I swear by myself, declares the Lord." Notice, Jehovah God swears by himself. Jehovah God does not swear by the fire that consumes. Jehovah God does not swear by the altar of obedience. Jehovah God does not swear by the sun and moon in the heavens. I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies. The giving of the only son is a key point in God's appraisal of the value of the sacrifice. The covenant swings both ways, meaning both parties to the covenant must be willing to sacrifice their only son. That means Jesus would be. The sacrifice of Isaac for the sake of the covenant was deeply symbolic of the future sacrifice of the Lamb of God. But not in the Quran's fairy tale of Ishmael. Murdering Ishmael was nothing but proof of the fear created by the reprobate and capricious deity. There is no comparison between the truth of Abraham sacrificing Isaac and the fairy tale of Islam reinforcing the sadistic and reprobate nature of Muhammad's Allah. Isaac served a purpose and was a symbol of God's plan to bless the world through Abraham. The story Islam creates to replace Isaac demonstrates the corruption of the religion's foundation. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.